Hello, everyone. Today, we're continuing with our deep dive of Richard Dawkins and Yen Wong's book, The Ancestor's Tale. In this episode, we're going to cover the Neolithic Revolution, also known as the First Agricultural Revolution. So, let's jump right in. The farmer's tale follows right on the heels of the Tasmanian's tale, which, if you'll remember, left us just a few thousand to a few tens of thousands of years ago. We're stopping today at about 12,000 years ago, the start of the Neolithic. Before we get into our tale, though, let's manage some chronological terminology. Neolithic refers to the time period encompassing 10,000 to 4,500 BCE and is the final stage of the Stone Age. The Neolithic is followed by the Bronze Age and later the Iron Age. While I would like to be able to give a simple date for the start and end of these periods, the truth is that I cannot. The interesting reason is that different cultures entered and left the Bronze and Iron Ages at different times. Thus, there is no single begin or end date. For example, the Near East left the Bronze Age around 1200 BCE, while Japan left around 300 BCE. Of course, this doesn't make any particular culture better or more advanced than any other. Cultures don't by necessity progress linearly from hunter-gatherer to pastoralist to sedentary societies. Numerous cultures are quite happy to continue either being hunter-gatherers, like the sand people of Africa, or nomadic pastoralists, like the Arabic Bedouin people. Indeed, cultures exist across the planet that cover the whole gradient. This tale is concerned with the origin of that gradient. It is interesting that the first agricultural revolution did not occur in one place and then flower outwards from there. There is no universal common ancestor of agriculture. Instead, agriculture was independently acquired in multiple regions: China along the banks of the Yangtze, sub-Saharan Africa, the Fertile Crescent between the Tigris and Euphrates, the New World, and even on islands like New Guinea. This is reflected by the fact that each region that independently acquired agriculture originally had its own unique set of staple crops. Of course, today, many of these crops are also grown elsewhere, but the places where they were domesticated are betrayed by the high diversity of the natural relatives that still remain there. These are called centers of origin, which were first identified by the Russian geneticist and botanist Nikolay Ivanovich Vavilov, the director of the Soviet Academy of Agricultural Sciences, who studied cereal crops to improve their yield to sustain the world's population. He went on expeditions to collect seeds from all over the world. Locating the center of origins and collecting seeds is important for many reasons: to prevent extinction of endangered species, saving seeds that can later be used to replace the crops that are lost to prevent famine, and to maintain genetic diversity that plant breeders need to develop better crops in the future. To this end, Vavilov set up a seed bank in Leningrad, currently St. Petersburg, one of the first in the whole world. He is rightfully revered as one of the great heroes of science, but regrettably, his story didn't have a deserving ending. Agronomist Trofim Lysenko led the political campaign that became known as Lysenkoism, wherein Darwinian evolution by natural selection and Mendelian genetics were rejected as bourgeois pseudoscience, and Lamarckism was promoted instead. Lysenko's campaign gained support from Stalin, and it led to the suppression of opposing views, often by firing, imprisoning, or executing scientists. Scientific research, particularly regarding genetics, within the Soviet Union effectively ceased to exist for decades, and the adoption of Lysenkoism in agriculture led to devastating famines. Some even occurred outside Russia, where the adoption of agricultural techniques promoted by Lysenko and his colleagues contributed to the Great Chinese Famine. This is what government-endorsed science denial looks like. Vavilov was a former mentor of Lysenko, and Vavilov actually encouraged his work when Lysenko was young. But later, as Lysenko gained political influence, Vavilov started to criticize his claims. One of Lysenko's claims was his hypothesis of vernalization. Some plants need to be exposed to a prolonged period of cold, usually during the winter, to induce flowering. This is essential in some crops, such as winter wheat. These are planted in the fall and germinate but remain dormant during the winter, only to resume growth and flowering in the spring. Winter wheat is better in quality, resistance, and yield than spring wheat, which is planted in the spring and harvested in the summer or fall. The downside is that winter wheat needs to be exposed to temperatures between 1 and 7 degrees Celsius for one or several months. If the winter months are unusually warm or too cold, the wheat fails to induce flowering and produce grain or freezes to death. This was already known by farmers and documented by scientists before, but what Lysenko did was chilling the winter wheat seeds in ice water, simulating the winter cold. After this treatment, the seeds could be planted in the spring and produce grain much earlier, without a natural winter season. Lysenko called this induction of flowering in plants vernalization, and we still refer to it with that term. However, Lysenko went off the rails by claiming that his artificial method of vernalization would transform winter wheat into spring wheat, and that the induced vernalization would be inherited in a Lamarckian fashion such that the next generation would not require natural or artificial vernalization. He was wrong, and Vavilov performed experiments that demonstrated this. After this, Lysenko began a political assault on geneticists, often calling out Vavilov specifically as an enemy of the people. Vavilov was arrested for his dissent in 1940 and died in prison in 1943. His death certificate only mentions decline of cardiac activity as the cause of death. But Vavilov likely died from the harsh prison conditions and starvation, an unfitting end for a man who dedicated his life to end hunger. The seed bank that Vavilov founded survived the siege of Leningrad that lasted over 2 years, largely due to the selfless scientists who diligently protected the priceless seeds from the cold, rats, the starving people of Leningrad, and from themselves. By the end of the siege, 9 of the scientists starved to death while guarding a room full of food. Their sacrifices would end up saving the lives of millions as the seeds that they protected were used to regrow the crop fields that were destroyed during the war. And in the 1970s, seeds from the bank were sent to Ethiopia, which helped end a deadly famine. If you eat something today that grew from a seed, it is likely a descendant from the same seeds that were protected in that seed bank. It still exists to this day in St. Petersburg as the Vavilov Institute of Plant Industry. Back to our tale. Before the Neolithic agricultural revolution, all human cultures were hunter-gatherers, and today, very few hunter-gatherer tribes remain. The transition from hunter-gatherer to agricultural societies was not a sudden innovation, it occurred gradually over many hundreds, if not thousands, of years. Even today, the boundary between the two ways of obtaining food isn't clear-cut. Some agricultural communities predominantly farm during the warm seasons, while hunting during the winter. And many hunter-gatherer tribes don't get their food exclusively from foraging, as they also spend time taking care of plants and animals. Pre-Neolithic hunter-gatherers, similarly, didn't solely rely on whatever nature happened to provide at any time. They acted as ecosystem engineers, managing the land often with the use of fire, in such a way not just for their own immediate benefit, but also to expand the habitat of prey animals and wild plants that they could later eat. The bona fide practice of agriculture, where specific plant species are grown as crops, is an extended form of land management that became gradually more sophisticated over many centuries, while the people of each generation wouldn't really have been consciously aware of this change. What exactly spurred the revolution has been a matter of debate. The question is particularly intriguing as our species existed for a period of time that is 10 to 20 times longer than the period between the revolution and today. What took so long? Why did humans begin to farm, not just once, but multiple times independently all over the world within a relatively recent and small time period? There are different factors proposed that are important in this transition. Communities became more sedentary and increased in population size and density. A large number of people staying within a small area is an obvious requirement for agriculture, but it may also have forced them to adopt agriculture as it provides much more food more reliably than foraging could. Why people began to associate into larger inclusive groups that remained in the same area isn't exactly clear. This may have been due to social, cultural traditions being developed. The late archaeologist Klaus Schmidt, who led the excavation of Göbekli Tepe, recognized that the foragers who built Göbekli Tepe needed a large food supply to construct it. So he hypothesized that the emergence of certain cultural traditions could provide the incentive for humans to adopt farming. There are also hypotheses that point to environmental factors. One involves climate change at the end of the last ice age, a bumpy time that includes an abrupt cooling spurt called the Younger Dryas period from 12,900 to 11,700 years ago, which R.J. Downard and I will be discussing in Volume 2 of The Rocks Were There. Quite a lot of human migrations were going on during this time, and going by paleo-monsoon records from marine and terrestrial strata, Earth's climate got much warmer and wetter. This period has been called the Early Holocene Humid Phase and lasted from about 10,000 to 7,000 years ago. As a result, floral diversity markedly increased at the start of the Holocene. Perhaps humans noticed a greater abundance and diversity of plants and became curious as to which plants were useful. Humans already possessed stone tools and so could process the various plant parts. Thus, which parts of the plant are involved in reproduction would not be that difficult to figure out, nor would the fact that seeds need to be buried. If humans could figure out the functions of seeds and that they need to be buried to grow, then perhaps humans could bury the seeds as they seasonally traveled. When a tribe returned to that same locality a year later, perhaps they would find a plant with fruit or vegetables where once was just soil. From there, it's not difficult to envision the tribe realizing that plants can be reliably grown given a certain set of starting materials. The next logical step would be the tribe planting more seeds, but rather than pursuing animal herds like normal, they stayed in one location. With plants being repeatedly grown, the gatherer strategy can be fulfilled in one place. As for the hunter strategy, this can be fulfilled with animal domestication. Selectively hunting members of a herd, like goats or cattle, was probably the precursor to herding and raising animals. This hypothesis that more humid climates facilitated the origin of agriculture gets some support from India and Pakistan. The earliest archaeological evidence of plant and animal domestication in southeastern Asia comes from a region known as Murghar, dating to about 9,000 years ago or 7,000 BCE. This coincides with the early Holocene humid phase. Native to Murghar are species of barley, wheat, cattle, sheep, and goats, all organisms which have been domesticated. It is really then no surprise that agriculture flourished in this region. Wheat and barley are winter crops, so people relied on the geologically recent increased monsoonal rains to grow larger amounts of crops in the winter. Later, around 4,000 years ago, a turn towards a more arid climate hit the Indus Valley Harappa culture hard, bumping them off the historical map entirely, but was more beneficial to the farmers of southeastern Asia, able now to grow sorghum, millet, and lentils during the summer. The climate giveth, and the climate taketh away. Interestingly, even 9,000 years ago, there was cultural exchange between the Middle East and southeastern Asia. The wheat varieties used in Murghar are actually native to southern Turkey, and a number of other cultural aspects of Murghar are extremely similar to cultures in Mesopotamia. The postures of skeletal remains, clay figurines, pottery prepared by sequential slab construction, circular fire pits filled with burnt pebbles, and large granaries are other major similarities between the civilizations. Thus, the deserts of Iran and Afghanistan were not complete roadblocks to early farmers. Researchers even managed to calculate in a 2014 paper the speed at which cultures spread from the Middle East to the Indian subcontinent, which appears to be about 0.65 kilometers per year. By contrast, the western spread of European cultures occurred at about 1 kilometer per year. So, what about the origin of domestication? Human domestication is often portrayed as humans being the only influential factor, while the plants or animals are just passive. However, recently a new hypothesis was proposed by Robert Spengler and colleagues, which says that the early steps in plant domestication were a natural and mutualistic coevolutionary process. At the end of the Pleistocene, many of the seed-dispersing megafauna became extinct, and humans had an increasingly dominant effect on the environment. This shift in the ecosystem forced plants to adopt new seed-dispersing methods, by being more attractive to humans such that we took over the role of seed disperser. This includes the acceptation of already existing traits. Even before domestication, there were plants that grew fleshy fruits to attract browsing megafauna, which would disperse the seeds after defecating them. One notable example is the avocado, which was originally eaten by giant ground sloths and gomphotheres in South America. After their extinction, the fleshy fruits were still attractive to humans. The importance of acceptation would also explain why only a restrictive number of species and families of plants were domesticated, since only those had the pre-existing traits that were beneficial to survive an anthropogenic ecosystem. This mutual coevolutionary hypothesis is interesting for another reason. Plants evolved to become beneficial to humans, but in return, this benefited themselves by incentivizing humans to become seed dispersers and eventually farmers. Remember, this happened after the ecosystem shift with the megafaunal extinction at the end of the Pleistocene, not long before the beginnings of agriculture. Hence, the mutual coevolution between plants and humans could be an important factor that explains why humans transitioned to agriculture around this time and not way before. After the initial steps of domestication were completed and crops were fully integrated in agriculture, humans had an increasing role not only in seed dispersal, but also in plant reproduction, inevitably leading to selective breeding. Selection for particular traits in those organisms was probably unintentional at first. Artificial selection or breeding of organisms for certain traits would have been realized later on. Cross two high-yield plants or animals and their offspring are predominantly high-yield. And the opposite happens if two low-yield organisms are mated. Or kill off any of the animals that are too aggressive, only preserve the animals that are docile. This will select for docility. We covered such selection for docility in our video, Silver Fox Experiment, so go check that out for more information. On the subject of canids, dogs were domesticated from the gray wolf, Canis lupus, multiple times independently across the world a few thousand years before the revolution began, between 15,000 and 12,000 years ago. The exact origin of domesticated dogs has been subject to debate, but recent paleogenomic evidence pinpoints two localities of dog domestication, Europe and East Asia. Though Darwin and several others had argued that modern dogs arose from gray wolves and golden jackals, behavioral, morphological, archaeological, genetic, and paleogenomic evidence strongly confirm gray wolves as the ancestors of dogs. The earliest definitive dog specimens date to between 15,000 and 13,500 years ago, and hail from France, Spain, and Germany. There is an interesting problem, however, concerning how to differentiate early dogs and wolves. Without genetic evidence, delineating the earliest iterations of domesticated wolves, or proto-dogs, from wild gray wolves is virtually impossible due to the wide variability within Pleistocene gray wolf morphology. Why, though, did humans start domesticating wolves at all? One notable hypothesis is that wolves scavenged at the edges of temporary human settlements. As wolves were in increasing contact with humans, the less aggressive ones were inadvertently selected by being offered food and shelter. This could have resulted in a mutualistic relationship between humans and proto-dogs, as dogs can provide protection and a hunting partner in return, suggesting perhaps that humans did not domesticate wolves, but rather, these two species entered into a mutually beneficial partnership. Indeed, this seems to have been the case from the start. Mass mammoth graveyards called mammoth megasites, dating to between 40,000 and 15,000 years ago, have been identified in Eurasia, which have been attributed to the invention of projectile technology and canid domestication. At these sites, not only are there masses of mammoths, but also unusually large concentrations of gray wolves and, surprisingly, Arctic foxes. These may represent early attempts at canid domestication, as the number of mammoths killed during this time greatly exceeds that of the preceding Middle Paleolithic. That fact may also hint at the reason for the demise of a number of Pleistocene animals, but I digress. So that's the farmer's tale. Humans first accidentally cultivated herds of animals and gardens of plants some 12,000 years ago, but over time they honed this skill, domesticating dozens of species. The next tale is going to take us from 12,000 to 50,000 years back, so stay tuned. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.